We're talking about some common dental myths that people have asked questions about in the comments below. And I'm here to help kind of clear them up and provide some information that you may not know about. I'm Dr. Brett Langston. I'm a prosthodontist and owner of Dental Implant and Aesthetic Specialists here in Brookhaven, Georgia. And I'm here to help you watch your mouth. Down in Brookhaven, with a smile shining bright, Dr. Brett Langston's working late into the night. With hands steady and a gaze so keen, he's the best darn prosthodontist you've ever seen. Let's start with dental myth number one. Cavities are irreversible. Now, this is a kind of a common perception that is partly true, but partly not true, and it really depends on a couple of things. So let's start with what is a cavity and what causes a cavity. So in order for a cavity to happen, you have to have a susceptible host, so the tooth has to be available to have the cavity grow in. And basically what a cavity is, it's little bacteria that when you feed them sugar, they create an acid, and that acid eats away that outer enamel layer of the tooth. And so it's two things have to happen. You either have to have the sugar for the bacteria to make the cavity, or you have to leave the bacteria there for a long enough time to let them work and take away that tooth structure. So the solutions to this are going to be either don't feed those bacteria the things they need to eat away your teeth, or constantly clean your teeth so the bacteria don't have a chance to make those cavities. Simple saliva in your mouth does a really good job of rinsing away these bacteria, but every time you eat or drink or put something new, you're basically coating your teeth in another layer of potential cavity-causing bacteria. So it's highly recommended that you at least rinse or floss after every meal, actually after every time you eat anything at all. So are cavities irreversible? Yes and no. Smaller cavities that are just starting to penetrate into that outer surface of tooth actually can be reversed. If you remove the substrate, if you remove the plaque and the bacteria that are causing that, you can stop the decay. And then if you have the right amount of fluoride and the right amount of nutrients that are going into the tooth can actually rebuild that tooth structure. Now, when cavities have reached into that internal part of the tooth, which is where the nerve is, has the blood supply and the innervation, unfortunately, at that point, it's not reversible because the nerve has been damaged. And so that's when you have to come see us, let us take out that unhealthy tooth structure. If it's reached the nerve, a lot of times you'll need a root canal, which is basically just a procedure where we go in and take out the internal nerve on the inside of the tooth and fill it up so it doesn't have any pain or discomfort. And then we can restore that missing tooth structure, either with a filling or a crown to protect the whole tooth. So myth number two, braces are only for crooked teeth. Now, while it's true that the main purpose of braces in orthodontics are to straighten misaligned and out of place teeth to further put them in the right path of draw so when they're biting and chewing and functioning, they're under the right angles of stress. But there are also many other reasons why we choose to utilize braces or orthodontic therapy. Number one might be to close gaps or spaces. If you have a space between your front teeth or if you have some spacing in the back, it's unesthetic or it's having putting a lot of pressure on the teeth in the wrong direction. Braces can help align everything and close gaps. Also, we can use braces to make spaces larger. So if you have a space between teeth that's not quite big enough for an implant or not quite big enough for an aesthetic result, a lot of times we can space those teeth out and give us the adequate space in between the teeth so we can do an implant or a dental bridge. Another option for orthodontics is to align the teeth. So not only if they're slightly crooked, it's more important to have them biting in the correct orientation. So sometimes it's an aesthetic purpose that we do orthodontics. A lot of times it's a functional purpose that we do orthodontics. But most of the time, the combination of two is to not only put the teeth in a more aesthetically pleasing place, but also to give them the proper support in the bones so that they last a long time. So when I talk about alignment, what I'm talking about is the actual way that the teeth come together. If teeth are off angled or a little not in line and you're putting a lot of biting force on them, a lot of times they can cause damage to the bone and the root structure of the teeth. So with orthodontics, we actually line them up so they're hitting right on top of each other in a functional manner so they can support and be strong. One thing that I think people underestimate is the amount of force that your jaw muscles can actually create. The average pounds per square inch pressure, or PSI, that a bite force has is anywhere in the 150 to 200 range. You can even go up to 380 to 400 on some of the more extreme scales, people that have certain jaw types and muscular setup of their teeth. And so when you're putting that much force and pressure on the teeth, even being slightly misaligned or being a little bit off can cause a lot of damage to the underlying bone and tooth structure. For example, the 150 to 200 PSI might sound really random, but it takes about a 90 to 100 PSI to crush an aluminum can. So if you think about it, your jaw can generate a lot of force and a lot of pressure. And so it's really important that everything is lined up and is supported in the right angulation. Myth number three, A knocked out tooth is gone for good and you can never replace it. So this might have been common back in your grandparents' day. If you lose a tooth, you just go on with your day and you probably don't have to worry about replacing it. But nowadays, after trauma especially, if a tooth is avulsed, which is the fancy word for comes out of the mouth, the number one most important thing to do if you're an adult is to actually put it back in your mouth, because the pH and the saliva in your mouth is going to maintain that as long as possible. Ideally, if you can put it back in the socket and you feel comfortable that you put it right where it was, that's the best. But the second best is putting it in your mouth, leaving it in your lips so you can kind of hold onto the tooth until you can see a dental professional. This may sound really gross, but if one of your children knocks a tooth out and you don't trust them to have it in their mouth, put it in your mouth. Your saliva and the pH of your mouth is gonna hold that tooth until their dentist can put it back in. If the tooth that came out is actually put back in the socket in a short enough amount of time, a lot of times the tooth will actually integrate back into the mouth. A lot of times we have to put some wires and brackets on there to stabilize it and allow everything to heal. And depending on the trauma, if there's a fracture to the bone, if there's underlying damage, it's obviously not gonna heal. But if there was a freak kind of accident where the tooth just shot out, there's a good chance we can put it back in and you can save that tooth. Now, things to be aware of down the line, at some point that tooth is probably going to have the nerve on the inside die and it'll need a root canal, which at the end of the day is better than missing that tooth. Unfortunately though, sometimes the teeth don't integrate and sometimes they do fail, but the nice thing is now we've got the capability with dental implants to pretty much restore and replace that missing tooth to make it look just like you never lost the tooth in the first place. Dental myth number 4, fillings last forever. In an ideal world, yes, that would be wonderful. I would love for all the fillings that we do to last forever. And in fact, the practice that I purchased has been around for over 50 years, and I've seen some patients that have the original fillings that the doctors before me placed in the early 70s. So it is possible. The most important thing for a dental filling to last as long as it's possible is number 1, you're in the hands of a good skilled practitioner. So you need to have a dentist who knows what they're doing. Number 2, it has to be a clean, healthy mouth. If you put a filling in a mouth that isn't well taken care of and well maintained, that filling is going to fail. So even in an ideally placed filling in a healthy mouth that everything is taken care of, the tooth, once it's had a filling, is weaker than it was originally. And a lot of times, judging on the size of the filling, that can kind of actually cause a little bit of wear and tear on the tooth over time, because a filling that goes right down the middle can act almost like a wedge and cause the tooth to flex a little bit. So unfortunately, over time, when fillings fail, it's usually right at the edge of where the filling meets the tooth structure. We get a little micro gap created, and a lot of times bacteria can sneak under there. And so when you get bacteria in a cavity right at the edge of a filling, a lot of times you have to go in there and remove that filling, remove that unhealthy tooth structure, and either place another filling, or if the filling was large enough, we have to go onto a crown to really protect the tooth. Some of the older fillings, the amalgam, these silver fillings that you see, while they may be unaesthetic, a lot of times they can last a really long time because it's an inert material and it's packed into that cavity. And as long as the mouth is healthy, those fillings will last a really long time. So you may be asking yourself, what can I do to make my fillings last longer? And that's a great question. The number one thing is a nice, healthy, clean mouth. Good home care, good oral hygiene is gonna remove bacteria and remove the potential for decay around the margins and the edges of those fillings. The second thing you can do is avoid things that cause damage to the teeth. So chewing ice, chewing on really hard, crunchy objects, especially on teeth that have bigger fillings, you're really just kind of asking for, at some point, for that filling or that tooth itself to break down. And there's a common saying in dentistry that every filling ends up growing up into a crown. And basically what that means is over time, as you replace the filling, you do get to a point where all of a sudden you have more filling than tooth. And at that point, you have to protect that tooth with a crown to hold it together. So that circles back to the necessity and the importance of coming to see us every 6 months. Coming for regular cleanings allows us to take x-rays and get really close magnified inspection of all those teeth. Every dental cleaning appointment, not only are we cleaning your teeth and making sure the gums are healthy, we're also inspecting all your existing fillings and crowns and bridges and implants, because we want to make sure nothing's sneaking up on us. Because a lot of times in dentistry, especially if you catch something really small, the solution is very easy to fix. A lot of times we can go in there and either patch it up or just replace the filling and keep it small. Unfortunately, if you don't have someone check on you and don't kind of catch these things early, they're going to grow into bigger and more expensive problems. And this dovetails perfectly into myth number 5. Teeth cleaning by a professional is not necessary. So a lot of times we have many patients that come in for cleanings every 6 months, never have cavities, never have any issues with their teeth. And so they ask us, is it really necessary for us to come see you? And my answer is always yes, for twofold. Number one, the most common disease in the whole world is called gingivitis. It's called inflammation of the gum tissue. Amazingly, 50 to 90% of the population has some form of gingivitis. Now, that may sound scary, but it really just means you have some kind of irritation and inflammation in the gum tissue. And unfortunately, as we get older and our manual dexterity goes down, we're not able to clean our teeth as well. Now, we have a greater selection of dental tools to deal with that, whether it's, you know, electric toothbrushes, which are great, water picks, water flossers that spray water and get rid of that debris. But unfortunately, no matter how good a job you did earlier, as you get older, the ability to clean your teeth doesn't quite hold up. And so it's really important to come see us because we can check every 6 months, make sure your gum tissue is healthy, make sure we don't see any developing cracks, problems. Radiographs, dental x-rays allow us to see inside the tooth and see the underlying bone structure. And a lot of times with a lot of diseases, and dental diseases are no different, everything looks fine and feels fine. But if you see something underneath the surface, you can treat it earlier. And I know some of you think you're doing a really good job, but you may not get all the way in the backside of the very, very last tooth, whether it's you're just tired that night or whether you've got a gag reflex or whether you just don't feel like getting back there. And so when you see us, we inspect every surface of every tooth to make sure nothing's sneaking up on us. And also at our office, every 6 months, we do an oral cancer screening to make sure that every tissue in your mouth is healthy. Myth number six, you have to floss before brushing. To be honest, to me, the more important thing is that you're doing both brushing and flossing. I think if you break it down and look at it, flossing first probably makes more sense because you go in between the teeth, you get to the areas where the toothbrush can't get to, you dislodge any food particles, any bacteria, any trapped things, and then the toothbrush goes in there, brushes away, and cleans everything up. But having said that, if you brush first and then you floss and then you rinse out with a mouth rinse afterwards, you're clearing that debris at the same time. I think you probably do the same analogy of, do you put milk in the bowl first or cereal in the bowl first? Most people that I know do cereal first and then the milk. But if you put the milk first and the cereal, you're still going to get the same result. So the take home message is, I don't really care which one you do first as long as you're doing both of them. Myth number seven, there's no need to care for baby teeth. They're just going to fall out anyways. While technically that's true, those teeth should fall out, it's extremely important to take care of them for a couple of reasons. Number one, if you don't, you're actually encouraging infection in the mouth. And infection in the mouth can spread to other parts of the body. You can also run the potential of pain, discomfort, and that can impact feeding and chewing. If you have pain in your mouth, you're not gonna be able to eat the quality foods that you need to. Also, baby teeth, while they aren't there for long, they do an important role of maintaining space. So each baby tooth has a location that it kind of is designed to go into. And it's designed to hold that space until the permanent tooth can come up underneath it. And so if you don't protect those baby teeth, a lot of times the permanent teeth don't know where to come in. And so a lot of, you'll get crowding, you'll get tooth misalignment, you'll get tooth misplacement. And another thing to kind of establish taking care of those baby teeth, you need to get in the habit of brushing your teeth and taking care of your teeth. And so if you start early, it just becomes something that you know how to do and you've done your whole life. So it's not so much about the individual baby teeth, it's more about the baby teeth as a whole and protecting the mouth. So when the permanent teeth come in, they're in the right location and you're ready to take care of them so you can maintain them for the rest of your life. So another question we get is, when should I start taking care of my infant or my baby's teeth, even when they just have gums? And what I would recommend is, even at that young age, start with a washcloth, rub the gums off just to get the baby used to the feel and the touch and the action of kind of cleaning the mouth off. Because at about 6 months, that first tooth is going to start breaking through. And at that point, I would highly recommend seeing either a pediatric dentist who specializes in baby, infant, child dentistry, because not only do they have an office and a team set up to handle that, but they've got extra training after dental school to really specialize in making sure everything is appearing as it should be and being taken care of properly. Myth number eight, everybody has wisdom teeth. So wisdom teeth are technically under the category of vestigial organs. That means that they're slowly becoming more and more obsolete. So think, for example, like the appendix. But in the mouth, wisdom teeth are way in the back. They're the very third set of molars. They're actually the most common missing tooth in the mouth, because when it comes to function and ability, very rarely do they come in the correct orientation and the correct location for people to use and function and chew with. And so it's actually very common when you're in that 14 to 18 range when healing is going to be easy, easy access. The tooth has actually formed, and sometimes it's locked in the bone. Sometimes they've erupted. Sometimes they come in at a weird angle. But that's the age where we usually recommend we have the wisdom teeth taken out because, like I said, recovery will be easier, and you don't really get any function or value out of wisdom teeth. Now, occasionally there are people with really large mouths that wisdom teeth come in, and my personal philosophy is that if the wisdom teeth come in and there's room for them to be there and you can keep them clean, I have no problem with wisdom teeth, but the majority of times that's not the case. The second most common missing tooth is going to be your lateral incisors, so these little baby teeth. And a lot of times people will be missing those, and that opens up a whole another problem with aesthetics, because at least the advantage of wisdom teeth, when you take them out, nobody's going to miss them. And last but not least, myth number 9, you will lose all your teeth eventually when you get old. That may have been the case maybe 50, 100 years ago, but with the advances with modern dentistry, nutrition, education, home care, a lot of times, a lot of our patients are keeping all their teeth or the majority of their teeth into their 90s and 100s. We've also got the ability to replace missing teeth now. So even people that are 70, 80, 90, if you're missing teeth, dental implants are a great option. The most important thing for maintaining your teeth is proper home care and seeing a dental professional to help you maintain that health. While it is true that a majority of aging patients are missing some or multiple teeth, the nice thing is the majority of patients we have, we're able to replace those missing teeth and get them back to a quality of life as if they had all their teeth. So don't worry that just because you're getting older means you're going to lose all your teeth. That's not the common way anymore. But do know that if things happen, accidents, aging, cavities, and you do lose teeth, we've got the ability now to restore those missing teeth, whether it's with implants, bridges, dentures, partials. We got lots of different ways to restore you back to a healthy, functional smile. So those are 9 of the most common myths that we hear and that people ask us questions about. But if you've got another myth or you've had another question, drop it in the comments below. We'll start to gather those. We'll make another myth-busting video, if you will. And if you have questions about your own dental care, come see us. We'd love to take care of you. I'm Dr. Brett Langston. I'm here to help you watch your mouth. Down in Brookhaven, with a smile shining bright, Dr. Brett Langston's working late into the night. With hands steady and a gaze so keen, he's the best on prosthodontist you've ever seen.